ولا يحصي نعماءه العادون ولا يؤدي حقه المجتهدون ثم الصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء المرسلين سيدنا ونبينا وشفي ذنوبنا وحبيب قلوبنا وطبيب نفوسنا أبي القاسم محمد وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المظلومين ولعنة الله على أعدائهم أجمعين من ليلة هذه إلى قيام يوم الدين أما بعد فقد قال الله تبارك وتعالى في كتابه المجيد وهو أصدق القائلين بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ومن يعمل من الصالحات من ذكر أو أنثى وهو مؤمن فأولئك يدخلون الجنة ولا يظلمون نقيرا آمنا بالله صدق الله العلي العظيم صلوات Alhamdulillah, all praise belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that have this opportunity to make a brief presentation this evening. Since these are the days of Muharram and Safar, wherein we try to recollect the events of Karbala and see that what we can learn from them. Having attended many majalis in our life, what we know that the mission of Imam Hussain was just not limited to that particular time when it happened. The tragedy of Karbala was not just an accident in history. Rather, Imam al-Islam had a greater mission and he prepared himself in such a way that the impact of his services, impact of his contribution, and of his Qurbani should stay for long, for centuries to come. And we can see that, right? That even today, after all these centuries, we remember Imam Hussain Islam and the events which took place in Karbala and thereafter. One of the things which Imam did to have a lasting impact of his mission is that he took with him women folk to Karbala. And after even the Shahadat of Imam Hussain Islam, the role which was played by these women. So this evening, in this short presentation, I would like to talk about the role of women in Karbala. The ayat of Quran which I recited is from Surah An-Nisa, ayat number 124. Allah says, وَمَنْ يَعَمَلْ مِنَ الصَّالِحَاتِ مِنْ ذَكَرٍ وَأُنْثَى. Anybody who performs good deeds among whether man or women, min dhakar wa unsa, wa huwa mu'minun, and if he is a believer, fa ulaika yadkhuluna fil jannati wa la yadkhuluna al jannata wa la yuzlamuna naqira, then they are going to enter jannat and would not be wronged even a bit. So if you see the role of women, we are aware about the role played by Janab Zainab alayha salam and Janab Sakina. These two women, of course, are mentioned quite often in our majlises, and we also visit them. When we go to Sham, visit Janab Qayya or Janab Sakina, and visit Janab Zainab there, and when you go there, in fact, we come to learn more about them, because every time you go there, there'll be a guide in your group, or there'll be a Maulana there who would remind us again about the contribution of these women. But besides these two women, a number of women were there who in fact played a big role in this whole mission of Karbala. And because of that, we have the lasting impact and impression of these incidents. Before we come to the events of Karbala, also in history, for example, we have got Nabi Abu Zar. Abu Zar, as you know, that because he was criticizing openly the hoarding of wealth by Muawiyah in Sham, he then, of course, was sent to Medina, and then from Medina again, he gave the instruction to Uthman to send him to Rabada, to a very deserted place completely. And he lived alone there with his family. And we are told that when he died, his wife, Umdhar, and his daughter were the one who gave him ghusl with difficulty. But the role they played, it so happened, this was in 33 age. It's just 2 years before when Imam Ali's Zahiri Khilafat came, in 33 age, right? And then it so happened that after they had just given him ghusl, Ibn Mas'ud happened to pass by Abdullah Ibn Mas'ud, and then of course Abu Dhar was buried. So you can see that women played a role even there. Right. But in Karbala, the role was even greater than that. First, if you see that they were there to encourage the men folk, that they realize that being as part of Imam Hussein's mission, to go and help Imam Hussein was necessity, and it was necessary that they should do it all devotion. So what I'll do, I'll also give you the names of some of these women, because sometimes people come to us and say, when the child is born, we would like please suggest to us some new names. And I always tell them, why don't you name the daughters? If you want new names, besides, of course, what we usually have, then either they name them with the names of mothers of imams. So if somebody asks your daughter, why did you name your daughter, for example, so-and-so, Sabika, for example, you can say, this is the name of this imam's mother. In the same way, for example, the women who were involved in Karbala will give you the names, so perhaps if somebody was trying to find some new names, can keep these names and also tell people that who this person was. In any case, Zuhair ibn Qayn, we are told that he was at that particular time, when the events of Karbala happened, at that time there was still a group who were known as Shia of Abu Sufyan, or Shia of Uthman. There was a group still. So Zuhair ibn Qayn with his wife, they had gone for Hajj in 68, and they were going back to Kufa. And Imam also left Mecca, and he was going to Iraq, right? And Zuhair ibn Qayn was always trying to avoid to be in the same place where Imam would station so that he would not meet Imam, because he was from different camp. But at the place known as Zarud, Imam camped there, and even Zuhair camped there. So when Imam realized that Zuhair had been camped there, he sent a message that I would like to see you. And when that messenger came with that message that Imam would like to see you, he decided not to go, because he was trying to avoid Imam in any case. When his wife came to know that he's avoiding seeing Imam, she rated him severely and say that, how is it possible that the grandson of the Prophet is calling you and you're not going? This is against civility. You can't do this thing. You have to go and just listen to him, what he has to say. So it was the wife of Zuhair ibn Qayn who actually pushed. And of course, in the process, when these women, when they were doing these things, they paid a big price. As you'll see just now, that when Zuhair goes to Imam, Imam discusses with him, and he's fully convinced with the mission of Imam. Fully convinced. He comes back to his wife and says that, I divorced you, now you can go back to your mother, and I have decided to just remove my camp from here and just join Imam Muslim Islam. So you can see the first price which she pays is that she gets separated from her own husband. But they do not mind. These are the women who are devoted. She was the first one who encouraged her husband, and in fact, Zuhair joined, right? Then there is another woman whose name is given as Dalham. Now this is, as far as Zuhair's wife is concerned, I could not find in history her name. But Dalham is the name of somebody who was the wife of Dalham bint Amr. She was the wife of one of the Sahabi of Imam, who actually gave his life in Karbala, right? And this Janada bin Kaab, she was the wife of this. And when he gave his life, after that, Dalham actually prepared his son. Right? No, salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Yeah, in fact, this Dalham was the name of wife of Zuhair ibn Qayn. She was the one who encouraged her husband. So this is the name, that we have the name, in fact. Besides that, we also know of the event of Janabi Habib ibn Mazahir, that when Habib ibn Mazahir receives letter from Imam. At that time, he takes the letter and does not, in fact, tell his wife immediately what happened. When she's asking what was the letter about, and when she insisted, and then Imam said that I have received the letter from the Imam, but then Majalis says that I received the Imam letter from the Imam, and he is asking me for the help. At that time, she's asking him, what have you decided? And we are told that Habib gave such an answer. Perhaps he was just trying to test her, or he did not want his plans to be known. So Habib ibn Majalis gave such an answer, whereby she realized that perhaps he is not planning to go there. So she's the one who says that, how is it possible that the grandson of the Prophet is calling you for help, and you are concerned about my welfare, that what would happen to me? If I was in your place, I would go. So again, you can see, besides Dalham, who was the wife of Zubayr ibn Kain, even Habib Mazai's wife is the one who encouraged her husband. And in fact, he wanted to go, Habib wanted to go, but she's the one who said, I do not mind, you go and don't be concerned about my welfare. Besides that, we also have those who prepared their men, folk, and children for the actual battle. On the eve of Ashura and the day of Ashura also, we find that these were the women who actually prepared the men folk and encouraged them to fight. We have an example of Wahab. She was the wife of Abdullah ibn Wahab al-Kalbi. She is the one who actually, when Wahab was fighting, when Abdullah was fighting, she went to the battlefront and she said that, for the sake, you know, by my father, my mother, I would like you to fight strongly and defend the descendants of the Prophet. She was encouraging them, and he said, I would do that. And of course, his ghairat, his honor did not allow him that she continued being there. So he asked her to go away. When she refused, he called Imam to convince her that she goes away. Wahab goes back to the tent, and Abdullah ibn Wahab al-Kalbi, salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Abdullah ibn Wahab al-Kalbi, in fact, continues fighting, and finally, he gives his life, right? He becomes shaheed. When she realizes that this is what has happened, she rushes to the battlefront, to the Maidan. She's just trying to just remove the blood and taking care of the body. At that time, Shimr was there, who gave the order to one of his slaves or soldiers that even killed this woman. So Wahab, who initially encouraged her husband to fight and fight severely and kill the enemies of Islam and protect the descendants of the Prophet, she also gave her own life. She was killed, and she's the first woman who became Shahida in the events of Karbala. This is Wahab. Besides that, we have another woman whose name is Bahriya. Bahriya is the one who initially I was trying to say. Bahriya was, in fact, was the wife of Janada bin Kaab. Janada bin Kaab is one of the companions of Imam. So Janada gave his life, Kaab al-Ansari. He gave his life defending Imam Hussein al-Islam. And when he became martyr, when he became shaheed, immediately after that, Imam saw a young boy going towards the battlefront. So Imam asked, who is this boy? And he was told that he's Amr bin Janada. So Imam tells to this Amr that, for your mother, the death of your father is enough. No, you go back to the tent. There is no need for you to go and fight. At that time, Amr says that my mother is the one who has actually prepared me and has instructed me to go and fight. And being a young lad, he goes and actually fights the enemies and gives his life. So this is, you can see, that Bahriya's name, who actually, after her husband became shaheed, her only perhaps support would have been her son, right? But she does not think about that. Young son, she doesn't think that, okay, what would happen to me now that my husband has died, let my son be there. he would grow up and would take care of me, or at least there is somebody in my family. But these were the women, you can see how committed they were, the role that they encouraged their husbands as well as also prepared their children. And we have usually on the eve of what Ashura, we hear Zakirin reminding us that how Janab Zainab alayhi salam, how Janab Umm Farwa, how Janab Umm Rubab prepared their children for these days, right? But besides that, you can see even that after giving the life, here is Bahriya who gives, prepares his own son and sends for the battlefield. The third role played by the women in Karbala was that they accompanied the men folk. Sometimes it is necessary. You can see, in fact, Imam was asked, right, by Ibn Hanafi, Muhammad ibn Hanafiya or Ibn Abbas, that why are you going to Iraq? And he said, Sha'allahu an yarani katilan, that Allah wishes to see me, that I get killed, right? And then he was asked, but why are you taking women folk? And Imam says, Sha'allahu an yarahunna sabaya, that Allah wishes to see them taken prisoner. So there was a plan, you can see, Imam had a plan by bringing women folk to Karbala. Imam knew that they can also play some sort of role. So then there were some women who came just to give company to their husbands. Muslim Ausaja is one of the sahabis of Imam who was of elderly age. He had seen the Prophet. In his lifetime, he had seen the Prophet. Not only that, he was the one who was expert horseman, and because of that, he was used at the time of conquest of Azerbaijan. There was 40 years before the events of Karbala. Azerbaijan was conquered partly on account of the efforts of Muslim Ausaja. You can imagine. So he was old, but when he came to Karbala, his wife accompanied him all the way until that time, on the day of Ashura. Then, of course, she moved from the camp of Muslim Ausaja to the camp of Imam, and she stayed amongst the women. So some of the women just accompanied their husband to give them that support. The whole idea, of course, of discussing this thing, that contribution of women, is that any mission, if you would like it to succeed, we need women to participate. You know, otherwise, if people, even sometimes, for example, you find individually, if you work together, right, there are people, some of the questions which we hear nowadays, of course, Maulana is here in this city, so he must be handling many of these cases, marital cases, but I know when I was in Vancouver, Edmonton, one of the things which always used to hear from these complaints is that everybody has his own way. The wife would like to pursue her own career, her own interest, husband would like to pursue his own interest, and sometimes on account of that, there is conflict in family, and everybody would like to go their own way. Even to the extent that even if they are children, they would rather have a divorce so as to pursue their own ways. But here it is that if you combine the efforts, right, then you can see, especially when a mission like this of Imam Hussein, there was a need of women. And women who were there, they contributed well. So the fourth role which they played is carry the message of Haq, especially the message of Islam according to Ahlul Bayt in Kufa, in Sham, and back in Medina. These women did this thing. Take Sukaina bint al-Hussein. Sukaina bint al-Hussein is daughter of Imam Hussein al-Islam. When she gave the khutbah in Kufa, after Janab Zainab had completed her khutbah, we hear, all Maktab will tell you, Sukaina bint al-Hussein also gave a khutbah. But in that khutbah, you can imagine, whilst in Kufa, what she does. She reminds people of Kufa about Imam Ali al-Islam. The same Kufa wherein Imam Ali was a Khalifa, right? Just a few years ago, his Khilafat was there after he moved from Medina to Kufa. So the last 3-4 years of his life, for example, so he got martyred in 41 age. So about 20 years ago, right? Imam was there. So Janab Sakina or Fatima bint Hussein, in fact, she says to people of Kufa, whilst giving that khutbah, that do you know that who Ali was? She refers to Imam Ali as Wasi Rasulullah, as one who was a successor. She says, that may Allah, I seek refuge in Allah, that to avoid lies, speaking lies and fabrication. Then she says, you have blessed Ali bin Abi Talib and entrusted him with the position of the guardian of the Prophet. So she first of all says, I am not lying. I seek refuge in Allah to lie or fabricate. That Allah entrusted Ali to be wasi of the Prophet. And then she says, subhanallah, al-maslub haqqu, the one whose right was taken away from him, which was snatched from him. She says this in Kufa while she is a prisoner. And she says, maqtul ghayra dhanbin, and he was killed without any kind of sin. So you can see that these women, even whilst they were prisoners, right? Today, for example, in many majalis, especially mahfil, when we get together, we praise Imam Ali Islam, and there is Nadar Ali, all those things. But you can imagine that these women, in this state, they did not forget talking about the greatness of Imam Ali Islam. And she continues that Ali was pious, was lenient, was pleasant, was unrivaled, you know, in his dedication, in his achievement, right? And she says that nobody can equal Ali in his devotion. And then, in fact, she says, "Hadayta ya Rabbi lil-Islami saghiran." Oh Allah, you in fact guided Ali while he was young boy, right? Wa hamatta manakibahu kabiran, and while he was a man, oh Allah, you in fact praise about his qualities. These are the things Janabi Fatima bint al-Husayn speaking in the court of Ibn Ziyad in Kufa. So you can see the role. That the mission of Imam Hussein did not just end on the day of Ashura. That the truth of Islam, the message of Ahlul Bayt continued, and this was continued by the women. So this is what she did. And of course, besides that, we also have the role that these women, they did not only talk about the truth, but they also exposed Yazid and what he has done. Because Yazid and Ibn Ziyad, they were trying to just do a propaganda there that Imam Hussein was Nauzubillah Baghi, that he was a rebel, and because he rebelled against the caliph of the time, and that is why he was killed and his family has been captured. These women folk actually exposed to people in Kufa and Sham to know that who was Yazid, what he has done, and who was Imam Hussein Islam, what was his position. So again, we have Umm Kulsum, for example, again in Kufa. Whilst in Kufa, you can imagine, and when we talk about Kufa, mind it, these are only few days after the events of Karbala. So the death, the tragedy has taken place only recently. It's not something which has taken place, for example, many months ago, years ago, that it's not fresh. It is still fresh, but see their strength, their bravery, and their audacity. They, in fact, addressed in the court of Ibn Ziyad, Umm Kulsum says, full of kufa, do not say a word. What is this? That your menfolk have killed our menfolk, and your women are crying on us. Then she says, do you know what kind of Do you know the enormity of the crime which you committed? And she reminded that, do you know who Hussein was? He was the grandson of the Prophet, the best of the men called after Prophet. She reminded them of what wrong they had done and how great Imam Hussein was. This is Janabi Umm Kulsum doing there and there in Kufa, right? So the women folk played a great role. Today we have sometimes people ask this question, that events took place in Karbala on the day of Ashura, right? Who was there to note down everything? Where do we get all these details? People ask these questions. And sometimes they even say that people have just fabricated this thing. But don't forget that these women folk, they continuously, immediately after the events of Karbala, even when they were prisoners, did mention what happened. So for example, Umm Kulsum says that how Imam Hussein Islam was killed in Karbala, and how sinless he was killed, and how they were treated. So these events, as it comes to us, and today, for example, we use as Ghamnu Bayan, they will try to just recollect the events of Karbala. Partly they've come to us from the women. They've played this role. Salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Finally, we also have these women who they played a lot of role, but even Marcia, which we have got some of the Marcias today, some of the very touchy and tragic Marcias, which were moving Marcias, were said by the very women of this Ahl Bayt. You find Marcia, which appears in the books of Janabi Rabab, when she remembers Imam Hussein al-Islam. See the Marcia of Mekulsum. Mercy of Janab Zainab. These things also, right from there, you can see the practice of mercy today we have got. We should not forget that this is the practice we started by these women for. And sometimes I'm really at loss to see that people pay less importance to mercy. Or for example, we say that when mercy has been recited, people just stand outside, only when majlis is being started then they come in. Mercy has a very special role. Usually, I like what the hadith says, that when somebody composes line of poetry for the events of Karbala or for even the praise of Ahl Bayt, we are told, لِكُلِّ بَيْتٍ بَيْتٍ. For every line or set of lines, there is a house in Jannat for such a person. So imagine that the role which mercy has played. So these women folk, besides passing on the message of Islam, of the Ahlul Bayt, besides exposing Yazid and Ibn Ziyad and their crimes, besides discussing the greatness of Imam Hussein Islam, besides encouraging their menfolk for the battlefront and preparing their children, they also said Marcia, which was so moving. Let me end today's presentation with one Marcia which Janabi Umm Kulsum said whilst entering Medina. When this kafila is now returning back, right, having gone to Kufa, then Sham, having prison there, then they were released, they came back to Karbala. But from Karbala, then they come back to Medina. At that time, this line of poetry, I'll just read in translation, but even in translation, you can see that how moving this mercy is, right? Janabi Umm Kulsum is entering Medina and says, Medina tu jaddina la takbalina. Oh, the Medina of our grandfather, do not accept us. Everybody would like to go back to the Watan, right, to hometown. Mekulsum and the whole caravan, kafila, has gone through all these difficulties. Finally, they were released. Having been released, now they are reaching Medina. But Mekulsum says, Medina tu jatina la takbalina. Oh, the Medina of our grandfather, do not accept us. Because we have come with grief and sorrow. So Umm Kulsum says, oh Medina Munawwara, do not accept us because we bring for you a lot of grief and sorrow. We left you accompanied with all the relatives and family. And in our return, there are neither men nor youths in our company, right? So this is what Umm Kulsum says. But do you see that in that Marcia, she's telling us that how we left you and how we are coming back. Whilst we left, men folk were there. The youths were there. Ali Akbar was there. Qasim was there. Abbas was there. Today, you don't find them. No, you see, they were in our company. At the time of our departure, we possess splendor and majesty. We are told that when Janabi Umm Kulsum, Janabi Zainab, when they left Medina, such a majesty, the way they left, right? That it is said, Mir Anis says in his Marcia, that the respect which Janabi Zainab received, that in fact when she was just sitting on the mahmil, Janabi Abbas was the one who took the shoes of Janabi Zainab, just out of respect, right? That was the majesty we had when we left, right? But now by returning, everything has been looted and plundered, she says. We were afraid of the oppression and contempt of the tyrants. We were the one who were the grandchildren of the prophets, right? But there was a time, although we only fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but there was so much oppression, so much zulm, that Janabi Umm Kulsum said that we are afraid and scared of oppression and contempt of the tyrants. Our chief companion, master was Imam Hussein, whom we left in Karbala as precious deposit forever. She says, we are now wandering without our guardian and supporter and have been engaged in mourning for our dear brother Hussein. This is how Janab Zainab Kulsoom enters Medina. So you can see the roles which they've played. No wonder that, for example, today we have these events of Karbala, which is so precise. Don't forget, it is the role of women. And it was Imam Hussein's foresightedness that he took them to Karbala. But this is the month of Safar. And as you know, this kafila is proceeding to Sham. We are told as this kafila was proceeding to Sham, there was a time suddenly that that neza, that spear on which there was the head of Imam Islam, just would not move further. Holy Malun, who was holding that spear, comes to Shimmer and says that this spear just does not go further. At that time, Shimmer says, don't worry, I know what to do. Azadaran Hussein, this Shimmer Malun comes, takes a whip, and just whips at Imam Sajjad al-Islam and says, we would like to know, why does not your father's head move? Imam Sajjad comes to Imam Hussein al-Islam and says, oh my dear father, why is it that we don't see you moving? What has happened? And Imam Hussein says, how can I move? Because my dear Sakina has been separated from this caravan. And when they came to know, Janab Zainab al-Islam, exactly like on the night of Shami Ghariba, Janab Zainab, having left all the women folk in the tent, at every kadam, at every step, Janab Zainab was looking for Janab Sakina. Again, here also, Janab Zainab is saying, oh, Sakina, where are you? Where are you? And then, of course, this caravan goes as it is proceeding. Azadaran Hussein, a time comes that, again, there was no water left in this caravan. When there was no water left with the army of Yazid, so the generals of Yazid said, we cannot go any further because there is no water. So they were just made to just stay under a tree or in a tent, whilst Ahlul Bayt, they were just made to stay under scorching sun. Until that time, Azadaran Hussein, water was brought. When water came, Shimmer Malun took the water and started serving the generals of his people, started serving. Janab Sakina al-Islam saw that Shimmer has water. She came to her aunt and said, oh my aunt, can I go to Shimmer and ask for some water? What can Janab Zainab say to Janab Sakina? Oh Sakina, how can you go and ask water from the qatil of your father? But Janab Zainab does not say anything. Janab Sakina goes to Shimmer and says, oh Sheikh, can you give me some water? And Shimmer does not give water. He just turns his face away. And Janab Sakina again asks again. Finally, having served water to everybody, Azadaran Hussein, what does Shimmer do? There was some water left. Janab Sakina was hopeful that this water will be given to her. Shimmer takes that water and just throws on the ground. And Janab Sakina falls down there. This is how the enemy was. That is why, as the Shair has put, Mazloom keh raha tha ke mai pyaasa pyaasa hoon. Ai Shimra tujhse maangta paani zara sa hoon. And you can see the attitude of Shimmer. When Janab Abbas asked Shimmer, when Abbas went to Farat and said, Shimmer, are you not ashamed that there is so much water flowing and the children of Hussein are dying of thirst? And Shimmer says that if the entire world is full of water, we would not give you even any one drop of water. That is why the Shair says, Hakim ka hukma ye hai ke paani bashar piye, gore piye, sawar piye, aur shutar piye, jo tishna lab jahan mein ho sab aan kar piye, haiwa piye, charind piye, janwar piye, kafir talak piye to na tum man akijiyo. Kafir talak piye to na tum man akijiyo. Ek Fatima ke lal ko paani. Allah ra'atul kum zalimina inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Rahimallahu man kara al-Fatiha. Bismillah.